The very term urban farming sounds like a paradox or a misnomer at the very least, but it is a real business and a movement, albeit a small one, that you can find in industrial greenhouses in a number of cities around the country. Our economics correspondent Paul Solman headed to Brooklyn, where the practice is growing, to find out more about what's behind it and whether it can be scaled up. It's part of our weekly series, Making Sense, which airs every Thursday on the NewsHour.
On a rooftop in Brooklyn, one fresh answer to an age-old problem: how to feed the world.
This greenhouse that we're standing in is 20,000 square feet, so about half of an acre.
So there's basil over there, that basil?
That's correct, that's basil. This is a medley of a blend of many lettuce varieties.
Lettuces, spices, tomatoes, all being grown on a rooftop in Brooklyn by Viraj Puri's urban ag startup, Gotham Greens. Puri says his hydroponic plot produces 20 times the yield per square foot of old-fashioned farmland.
But growing lettuce in New York City?
Real estate is extremely expensive in New York City, with not a lot of arable land, not a lot of open space. But what we found is that rooftops are a vastly underutilized resource. We found it as an opportunity to monetize rooftops for building owners who weren't using them for anything.
Meanwhile, the demand for fresh food that hasn't had to be shipped from California, Mexico, or even further afield is also an opportunity to sell to consumers who want to eat locally, the locavores.
Locavorism, as it's known, is certainly a growing trend. And I believe it's not just because people want food that's grown closer to them. That's a big part of it, but it's what that represents. It represents spending dollars closer to home. It represents artisanal, small batch, craft manufacturing, and not large, anonymous agribusiness.
And this urban farm grows produce that doesn't travel food miles, but merely food footsteps, going farm to shelf at the Whole Foods market downstairs. The produce is more expensive to grow, given that indoor hydroponics depends on artificial light and must import all its water and nutrients. The pests come of their own volition.
Despite us being on a rooftop in an urban area, those aphids and thrips make it in here.
Aphids and thrips?
That is correct, aphids and thrips. So we will actually release predator insects in the greenhouse that will prey on the bad insects. And we do that on a weekly basis. We create a little insect warfare here in the greenhouse.
So literally behind me while I'm talking to you, and behind you for that matter, there's little predator insects eating little aphids?
Yes, indeed. They're amongst our most valuable team members.
Meanwhile, across the Hudson River in deindustrialized Newark, New Jersey, empty buildings are being similarly deployed.
So this is a farm, and there's going to be more acreage soon?
So these systems are 20 feet high. We're now building them that are 36 feet high. This is 80 feet long. So now imagine these 36 feet high, 80 feet long, and 35 of these stacks.
In an abandoned paintball and laser tag facility, Aero Farms is cultivating tray upon tray of leafy greens, the equivalent of 10 acres worth down on the farm, and is building 70,000 more square feet in Newark and beyond. No sun, no soil, just the occasional beard net if you get too close to the merchandise.
I'm wearing this because we don't want any mustache hair in the kale.
Yes, it's just an extra precaution to make sure there's reduced risk of food contamination. If I didn't shave for 24 hours, I would wear a beard net as well.
But if some of the concerns seem trivial, the overall purpose of addressing a world food crisis is obviously not. And Aero Farms co-founder David Rosenberg warns,
the food crisis is already here. Some people attribute the Arab Spring and the catalyst of that to a sharp increase in the price of wheat.
How much of a contribution to the solution is farming like yours?
It definitely has a place. Whether it's 5%, 10%, 50%, it's hard to say. It depends how fast it's adopted.
Rosenberg intends that to be as fast as possible. And he sparked interest from investors the world over, including China's immense sovereign wealth fund and one of Britain's most prominent investment trusts, both touring Aero Farms the day we were there.
And so those folks are thinking about investing in, or are going to invest in, what you're doing here and abroad?
Correct.
So are there going to be facilities like this in China? Are there already?
eventually the vision is to build these farms all over China.
And what's the key to the technology? At Aero Farm's R&D facility, a former disco, marketing director Mark Oshima explained.
Aero Farms, aero meaning growing with aeroponics, sort of misting the roots with nutrients. It's much more efficient than hydroponics, much more effective in terms of delivering the nutrients and less water.
So the little roots are like hanging in air as opposed to in the soil.
What makes us unique is our growing medium. We actually have a patent around our growing medium, which is cloth.
And the cloth is made of what?
Our proprietary growing cloth is made out of 100% recycled plastic. Each one of our growing cloths is made out of 26 water bottles that we're taking out of the waste stream.
And this is what's known as vertical farming or verticulture.
When we think about vertical farming, we think about how many vertical beds of growing can we get in any kind of space. It's about that productivity per square foot. We're growing a wide range of different leafy greens. In red komatsuna, we have the green arugula, we have pak choi, we have ruby streaks mustard greens.
So you just
enjoy it. That's one of the great things ready to eat here.
Yeah, kind of mustardy. And the arugula? This isn't your own proprietary arugula, is it?
It's our own proprietary growing algorithm, our recipe of dialing in on that flavor.
And speaking of growing, like Aero Farms, Gotham Greens is as well. It's now running two other urban farms in New York, including a brand new rooftop greenhouse in Queens, three times the size of the one above Whole Foods. And they'll soon be opening a rooftop in Chicago.
But there's a limit to how big you could be, right? I mean, you can't become the next Cargill or General Mills or something, right?
Perhaps one day. The sky is the limit when it comes to agriculture.
But hold on, says agricultural economist Jerry Nelson. There is a global food crisis in the making, he thinks. But as things stand, the world won't be fed by hydroponics alone.
And you're going to have some expenses that you don't have when you're growing vegetables in the countryside. You want to go to grow lights, then, you know, you've got big expenses for electricity. You've got to have clean water. And you know, if you're talking about doing this in Delhi or Nairobi, the question is, where are you going to get the right amount of clean water?
So no, indoor farming may not be the answer to the world's food needs, but it's doing good and growing business in urban America. This is economics correspondent Paul Solman, now trying to eat all the local leafy greens I can find when not reporting for the PBS NewsHour.